Let me welcome members to the third meeting in 2016 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, and as usual, remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones as they may accept the broadcasting system. We have received apologies from Cameron Buchanan and from Mary Fee. Item one is Declaration of Interests, and I invite John Scott, who's attending for the first time, to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. I have nothing to declare.
Thank you. John is, of course, here to substitute for Cameron Buchanan, and I welcome you to our meeting. Item two on our agenda is for us to decide whether our consideration of issues for and a draft of its our legacy report, a draft report and standing order rule change on our legislation inquiry, and papers on lobbying, legislation and the Scotland Bill should be taken in private at future meetings. Do members agree to take them in private? We are agreed. Thank you very much. We now come to the main item of business today, which is the Lobbying Scotland Bill. We are undertaking stage two proceedings on that bill. Let me remind members that if stage two is not completed today, then the committee will be required to meet next Thursday, the 11th of February. I welcome Joe Fitzpatrick, the Minister for Parliamentary Business, and his accompanying officials. Officials, of course, are not permitted to participate in the formal proceedings. I also welcome Neil Finlay, who has lodged a series of amendments. Members should have the bill, the marshalled list and the groupings, which sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be debated. Our task is to consider all of the amendments and also to agree each provision of the bill. For the debate on each group, I will call the member with the lead amendment in the group to open the debate on that group by moving the lead amendment and speaking to all amendments in the group. I will then call any other members who have lodged amendments in the group to speak to all of the amendments of the group. I will then call any other members who indicate to me they wish to speak in the group, and I shall take the minister last if he does not have an amendment in the group. Finally, I will invite the member who opened the debate to wind up and indicate whether they wish to press or to withdraw the lead amendment. Any member present may object to the withdrawal of an amendment. If there is an objection, we'll proceed straight to the question on that amendment. That is, there's no division on whether an amendment may be withdrawn. It will follow the normal procedure if a division is required. When we reach amendments on the marshalled list that have already been debated, I will ask the member to move or not move. If a member who lodged the amendment does not move it, any other member present may move the amendment instead. We come to the first grouping, which is on definition, and I call the Amendment 14 in the name of Neil Finlay in a group on its own, and I invite Neil Finlay to move and to speak to Amendment 14.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to speak to the committee this morning. As it stands, I believe the bill lacks a clear definition of what lobbying is. It sets out core concepts, but it doesn't set out a definition. And this amendment provides a definition that everyone can clearly understand from the outset. It would strike me as absurd to introduce a bill without actually defining what we actually mean by the term. By the term lobbying. When consulting on my bill, I looked far and wide for a sound definition, and this was the one used by the House of Commons Public Accounts Committee, and I found that to be the best definition I could find. I consulted on it widely, and it was accepted as a fair definition, and I think this will help the bill and those who will be affected by it. I think it will help them significantly.
Thank you. No members indicated. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and I thank Neil Finlay for lodging his Amendment 14 and the explanation of the purpose and effect, and recognise Mr Finlay's particular interest in this area and the area of transparency in general. Convener, I think Amendment 14 is, as Mr Finlay said, it's intending to give a definition of what lobbying is before the bill moves on to define the scope of regulated lobbying. It's our view that this amendment would introduce an unhelpful ambiguity to the bill. Section 1 of the bill already gives a clear and legally certain outline of what type of activities is deemed to be lobbying. the types of lobbyees and lobbyists to be included, and the means by which communication is made. Including a further definition is likely to lead to confusion over what is and what is not regulated lobbying. For instance, the words in a professional capacity do not clearly define what lobbying is intended to be covered, unlike the existing exemption in Schedule to the Bill on when payment is relevant. Nor do I think it's wise to include a definition that seeks to highlight the intention of the lobbying activity. It already is clear that lobbying is an attempt to influence decision makers. The approach taken in Amendment 14 was in particular criticised by the OECD Comparative Review of Legislation for Enhancing Transparency and Accountability, and these particular specific words were removed from the Canadian regime as they did not allow their legislation to be enforced as introduced. Finally, the inclusion of parliamentary liaison officers as lobbyees is unnecessary, as lobbying MSPs is already caught by the scope of the bill. A PLO can only be appointed on the basis that they are an MSP. While I recognise the member is trying to be helpful and take account of other amendments that have been lodged, 15, 16, 18, 32 and 33, it's my view that this amendment risks introducing unnecessary ambiguity and confusion about the definition of regulated lobbying in the bill. Accordingly, I invite Neil Finlay not to press Amendment 14, but if he does, I invite the committee to resist it.
Thank you, Minister. I invite Neil Finlay to wind up and indicate if he's pressing his amendment or withdrawing.
Convener, and I think it stretches it somewhat that the Minister claims that by providing a definition you actually make the bill more ambiguous. I think the bill is ambiguous as it stands without that definition, and I certainly want to push the amendment.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. Can I have an indication of those who are in favour? One. Can I have an indication of those who are against the amendment? Five. The result of the vote is those in favour, one, those against, no. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I now move to the next grouping, and I call the Amendment 15 in the name of Patricia Ferguson, grouped with Amendments 1, 3 and 18. I must point out that if Amendment 15 is agreed to, I will not be able to call Amendment 1 because it will be preempted. I invite Patricia Ferguson to move Amendment 15 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. The genesis of my Amendments 15 and 18 is the evidence presented to the committee by a number of witnesses. The idea that the bill, as it's currently drafted, should only cover oral communication was variously described as, and I quote, clearly insufficient by Ash Scotland, ludicrous by Dr. Dinan of Spinwatch, and Professor Chari of Trinity College Dublin advised that he was unaware of any other legislation that contained such a restriction. I think we would all recognise that in 2016 much of the communication that takes place with politicians is by letter, by telephone and by email. Lobbying and lobbyists use all of the methods of communication open to them. And if we want this bill to have any real effect, it must recognise this fact. That was the conclusion of the majority of the members of this committee and was recognised in the Stage 1 report on the bill. So I hope today that members will support those amendments and give effect to our recommendations. With regard to the Minister's Amendment number 3, I would like to support the principle that video conferencing should be captured by the bill, but I'm afraid that the wording of the amendment is such that it re-emphasises the belief that the focus of this bill is on face-to-face communication only, and I cannot therefore do so.
Thank you. I invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 1 and other amendments in the group.
Thank Patricia Ferguson for bringing forward her amendment. I think it's important that issues which have been raised through the course of the bill are aired at Stage 2. Convener, I understand the purpose of Amendments 15 and 18 is intended to extend significantly the definition of regulated lobbying to include a wide range of forms of communication beyond face-to-face and in-person communications which are currently set out in the bill. the issue of what types of communications should be included within the scope of regulated lobbying attracted considerable interest during stage one and continues to be the content of much lobbying of MSPs on this bill. On both sides, the government's view continues to be that face-to-face communication is the most significant and influential means of conducting lobbying and that the focus of the bill should remain on such activity. However, I have reflected carefully and I'm of the view that the bill should incorporate all face-to-face communications regardless of the means of delivery. That's why I've brought forward amendments 1 and 3 to ensure that video conferencing and equivalent means will be treated as regulated lobbying activity. Convener, I believe that this will maintain the proportionality of this bill and will avoid creating a registration scheme which in practice might discourage access to and engagement with MSPs and ministers. The government is not persuaded that a case has been made to justify altering the scope of the bill in the way proposed by Patricia Ferguson to include other forms of communication such as telephone calls or written communications within the concept of regulated lobbying. Doing so would place a potentially very significant burden on organisations seeking to engage with Parliament and government. It would not be in anyone's interests for us to commence with a regime that is unwieldy and off-putting and leads to criticism of the legitimate public interest that lies at the heart of what the bill is seeking to achieve. Convener, in a separate group, the committee will debate the merits of amending amendments requiring the Parliament to review the operation of the bill after 2 years. I believe it is through that review that Parliament should reflect on whether face-to-face communications should continue to be the principal focus of the regime or whether it should be extended to other forms of communication. That approach would enable the Parliament to build an evidence base to justify imposing these controls, taking into account the day-to-day operation of the register, both for lobbyists and the Parliament itself in running the register. For those reasons, I invite the committee not to support Patricia Ferguson's amendments 15 and 18.
I invite Patricia Ferguson to wind up and to press or withdraw her amendment.
Thank you, Convener, and I do intend to press the amendment. I'm sorry that the Minister feels that the evidence taken by the committee has not resulted in an amendment that he can support. And I don't want to take the committee's time too much this morning, Convener, because we do have a very full agenda. But I would just point out that the idea that we should review the bill to see whether or not at a future date we would want to include matters such as the method of communication seems to me to be looking at the bill the wrong way round. I think we should start by recording all of the categories of communication that would be covered by my amendment and by the bill and review to see whether or not those are appropriate at that stage. We cannot review something that we have not been capturing in information. And the only way we will be able to capture in information and find out the extent of the lobbying that goes on and the purpose and effectiveness of that communication is by, from the beginning, capturing all forms of communication. If a future Parliament decides that that has been onerous and has meant that we are not doing what the bill wants us to do, then at that point it could be changed. But to my way of thinking, doing it the other way round is entirely contrary to the purpose of the bill.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of the amendment please indicate? Would those against the amendment please indicate? There was one vote in favour of the amendment and 5 votes against the amendment. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 15, and I invite the Minister to move formally.
Formally moved.
The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We now come to the next group, and I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, group with amendments 16, 8, 32, 33 and 1. I invite the Minister to move Amendment 2 and speak to all the amendments in the group.
Convener, the committee's stage one report recommended that the government consider bringing forward amendments to broaden the definition of regulated lobbying to include communications made to other public officials. A number of stakeholders from both sides of the debate have also called for this. As such, the Government's Amendment 2 proposes to amend the definition of regulated lobbying at Section 1 to include special advisers as lobbyees. Amendment 11 is consequential on Amendment 2 as it defines special advisers. As I have continually said throughout the development of the bill, I'm open to considering all possible changes as long as they continue to meet the principle of a proportionate and simple regime. I can see the arguments that have been made in relation to special advisers, given their distinctive roles that they play in supporting ministers. It is for that reason I have decided to bring forward this amendment. I'm unable to support Patricia Ferguson's Amendment 16 and 32, which would seek to also include all senior civil servants and would enable the Parliament to add any other civil servants in the Scottish Administration at a future point by parliamentary resolution. I would, however, wish to make clear to Patricia Ferguson and to the committee that I am continuing to give careful consideration to possible further amendments which would bring certain senior civil servants within the regulated scope of the framework. It will be important to ensure the scope of that amendment is correct, and consultation with trade unions on this is underway. I'd be happy to meet with the member to discuss amendments for Stage 3 in the light of that consultation. Patricia Ferguson's Amendment 1632 also seeks to add parliamentary liaison officers as lobbyees. The amendment is unnecessary, as PLOs are appointed by virtue of being an MSP, and therefore any lobbying of them in that capacity will already be covered by the bill as drafted. Convener, the Government has also brought forward Amendment 8 to remove Section 21G from the bill. The purpose of that provision was to act as a catch-all for any government and parliamentary functions not already defined within Section 2.1. On reflection, the Government considers that Section 2.1G to be unnecessary on the basis that any regulated lobbying should only be in connection with government and parliamentary functions specifically defined in Section 2.1A to F. Conversely, communications that could clearly be viewed as not being lobbying might risk being captured unnecessarily and discourage engagement. It might assist members if I give a couple of examples of communications that the government views as inappropriate to capture. So, firstly, a local housing association might wish to take forward housing development in a particular constituency and might seek to meet, for instance, the local MSP to inform the local MSP of its intentions, seeking their views. But the MSP is not being invited to take to make any specific actions of the sort covered by 2.1A to F. Another example might be a Scottish business which is in financial trouble and wants to meet with the local MSP to communicate that fact as a courtesy and nothing more. So I move amendments 2 and would invite Patricia Ferguson not to move amendments 16, 32 and 33. If the member wishes to press her amendments, I invite the committee to oppose them.
Thank you. I invite Patricia Ferguson to speak to Amendment 16 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This set of amendments recognises that ministers and MSPs are not the only people who may be lobbied. During the course of our deliberations in this committee, we looked at this and took evidence which recognised that in other jurisdictions, the list of those who may be lobbied goes considerably further than the categories in this bill. The committee recognised that many public officials wield considerable power and make important decisions about policy and financial matters, and that they should also be covered by this legislation. Once again, as this was a recommendation of the committee in its report, I would hope that it would be supported. I very much appreciate the Minister bringing forward an amendment that contains special advisers. However, in my view, it does not go far enough. My Amendment 32 seeks to add to the list of those who might be considered to be in receipt of communication deemed as lobbying. Amendments 16 and 33 attempt to include parliamentary liaison officers in that category. Now, it can and has been argued that this group of MSPs are already covered by the bill, but I want to reinforce that they have a particular status in relation to their role in assisting ministers. This amendment seeks to protect them specifically from allegations that they may have themselves been lobbied in that role, and that consequently they may in turn have lobbied the minister on behalf of a lobbyist. I very much hope the committee will support those amendments, but I accept that that's probably unlikely.
Minister, do you wish to wind up?
Just very briefly then, in terms of PLOs, I think probably for the record, it's maybe helpful for me to be absolutely clear that PLOs are captured in that capacity. So for somebody to suggest that they are having a meeting in the capacities of PLO, that does not provide any sort of loophole. They are absolutely clearly covered by the bill as MSPs. In terms of the amendments related to other senior civil servants, I do hope Patricia Ferguson will withdraw those amendments, and as I said, I would be happy to work with her in the light of the discussions that the government is having with trade unions in terms of bringing forward an amendment at stage three to go further. But I think it's appropriate that we make sure that any actions that were taken are taken carefully and fully considered, and I would hope that the member would agree that consultation with trade unions is part of that process.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you. I call Amendment 16 in the name of Patricia Ferguson, already debated with Amendment 2. I invite Patricia Ferguson to move or not move.
Moved.
The amendment is moved. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour please indicate? Would those against please indicate? On Amendment 16, there was one in favour and five against. The amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 15, and invite the Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 3 please indicate? Would those against Amendment 3 please indicate? On Amendment 3, there were five in favour and one against. The amendment is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 9, 10 and 12. I invite the Minister to move Amendment 4 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, this group of amendments are all minor tidying up amendments. Amendment 4 will put beyond doubt who should be caught and how by the definition of regulated lobbying. Section 11B of the Bill sets out the categories of people that, in the course of business or other activities, make communications which may count as regulated lobbying. This definition is already wide and covers employees, directors, partners or members. This is a clarificatory amendment which will simply ensure that all types of paid office holders within an organisation will be included in the definition of regulated lobbying. Amendment 9 corrects a drafting error inserting the word meet in section 24.6D. The amendment has no policy effect. Amendment 10 corrects a drafting error in section 45. It will change an erroneous use of the word or to of, ensuring that the relevant provision makes sense. The amendment has no policy effect. Amendment 12 removes the words in return for payment from section 48 of that bill. This avoids duplication of provisions made in section 1, which defines activity that is regulated lobbying. And again, the amendment has no policy effect. I move Amendment 4 in my name and invite the committee to support Amendments 9, 10 and 12.
Thank you. No one is indicating they wish to speak. Anything further to say, Minister?
No, thank you.
The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 17 in the name of Neil Finlay, grouped with Amendments 23, 24 and 26. I invite Neil Finlay to move Amendment 17 and speak to all the amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. Amendment 17 relates to thresholds for lobbying, and this, I believe, is necessary to capture lobbyists involved in significant amounts of lobbying activity. It ensures that small-scale lobbying is not caught by the Act, and it addresses concerns relating to the alleged burden or danger of restricting activity or engagement with this Parliament by small community organisations, charities, businesses, etc. And I am delighted to say it will reassure Gil Paterson that he can still send his Christmas card. This is a proportionate measure and one that reflects some of the concerns raised during the bill. Thresholds are used in other jurisdictions and should be included in the bill. Amendment 23 is all about scale. There's a real difference between spending £100 on lobbying or spending £50,000 on lobbying, and again, for the purposes of openness and transparency, it's vital for the public to see how much money and how much time is spent on lobbying activity. This can allow the public to access whether there is a correlation between the actual money spent and effort spent on lobbying and the tangible benefits from that activity. For example, how much time, effort and cash is spent in order to change the law on X, Y or Z, or how much is spent on attempting to win contract 1, 2 or 3. Over a third of lobbying registers around the world apply thresholds. They work, and suggestions to the contrary, I believe, are a red herring. Amendment 24, this is a banding system which provides a framework for which registrants are able to disclose the levels of spending and time spent on lobbying. In putting this amendment forward, I've taken account of the concerns raised by the sector about commercial sensitivity of expressing actual amounts spent. So there's a banding system to take account of that. And no specific details of, for example, contracts for lobbying would be included. I think this is helpful, and I think it's merely a way in which we can make the register work better. Amendment 26 is intended to update the current proposals to ensure that thresholds are dealt with appropriately throughout the bill.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank the member for his amendments. I see two purposes behind Neil Finlay's amendments. Firstly, to offset, to offer a threshold to remove low-value lobbying from registration scheme, and secondly, to include financial data and time spent lobbying on the register. While I have sympathy for the first aim, in particular in light of the concerns expressed by members during the Stage 1 debate on the bill's potential impact on constituency-based activities, including Mr Paterson's Christmas card, I consider the amendment in that form would add unnecessary complexity and ambiguity to the registration process and for registrants submitting information returns. I would, however, wish to give further consideration to whether it would be possible to exempt lobbying on of a de minimis nature and to return to the matter in Stage 3. And I think I'd be happy to provide the committee with an update on my thinking on the matter ahead of lodging deadline for amendments. As to the second aim, the government's view is that no case has been made to require registrants to provide financial data in connection with regulated lobbying. The power available to the Parliament at Section 15 of the bill would allow the detailed operation of such requirements to be developed without undue haste. The government also proposes that such matters are best dealt with in the context of a formal review process as proposed in Amendment 13. I therefore ask Neil Finlay not to press Amendment 17, but if he does, I ask the committee to resist the amendment.
I invite Neil Finlay to wind up and indicate if he's pressing or withdrawing.
I'll be pressing the amendments, and I would suggest we just go to the vote.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of the amendment please indicate? Would those against the amendment please indicate? There was one vote in favour and five against. The amendment is not agreed to. I call Amendment 18 in the name of Patricia Ferguson, already debated with Amendment 15. Patricia Ferguson to move or not move?
Move.
Amendment 18 is moved. The question is that Amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There'll be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 18 please indicate, please? Would those against please indicate? There was one vote in favour of Amendment 18 and five against. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendment 6 and 7. I invite the Minister to move Amendment 5 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, the amendments in this group address a number of topics. Firstly, in the Stage 1 report, the committee helpfully suggested the government give consideration to a potential exemption within the schedule to all trade union communications. Government agreed with the committee and has brought forward Amendment 7 to that effect. The government has sought to maintain a fair and balanced approach throughout the development of the bill, so the amendment proposes to exempt communications in relation to terms and conditions of employment that are made by trade unions or employers. The Government recognises that through experience of the operation of the Register, the need for further exemptions could be identified. Therefore, the Government proposes Amendment 5 to give the Parliament the power by resolution to add to the current list of exclusions contained within the schedule of the Bill. That power will also give the Parliament the ability to amend or remove any such additions made. Amendment 6 is lodged in response to the Committee's request for the Government to look again at the exception in the schedule to the Bill in respect of meetings initiated by members or ministers. I welcome the Committee's assistance in helping to correctly frame the exception and avoid it creating a potential loophole for lobbying activity to go unregistered. Amendment 6 would therefore make clear that the exception to a requirement to register extends only to the provision of factual information or views in response to a request. I move Amendment 5.
Is there anything else you wish to say before I move to the vote, Minister? No. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The question is that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 5. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 5. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that the schedule be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 2. I invite him to move formally.
Formally moved.
The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Sections 3 and 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 19 in the name of Neil Finlay, grouped with Amendments 20, 21 and 22. I invite Neil Finlay to move Amendment 19 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. These amendments address the issue of the so-called revolving door, where former ministers, senior civil servants, special advisers and the like working at senior levels of government build up an extensive contact list of influential people and then leave that post to go on and use and exploit that contact book for commercial or financial gain, a situation which is not open to ordinary members of the public. These amendments would mean that the previous 5 years' employment history of that lobbyist were out there for all to see. This is a transparency measure and it's proportionate. It's important that the public are able to observe whether a lobbyist has worked recently in or for the very government that he or she is now lobbying. This amendment helps with that, and I believe it is an essential part of this bill.
Minister.
Again, thank Neil Finlay for lodging his amendments and his explanation of the purpose and effect. Amendments 19, 20, 21, 22 all seek to introduce a requirement for those who register to provide retrospective information about their employment history or the employment history of those lobbying on their behalf. The Government does not feel a case has been made to require those who undertake lobbying activity to publicly have their past employment history disclosed. It's important to remember that these amendments would apply to all people who are undertaking regulated lobbying. It's not clear that such information would always be relevant to the lobbying activity which has been undertaken. It would also require organisations to reveal personal details in situations where the individual might not have agreed to that when they took up the employment. Individuals themselves may have legitimate reasons for not wishing to disclose such information publicly or to their current employers. The committee noted in its Stage 1 report that it was satisfied that the inclusion of individuals' names on the register will enable those with an interest to probe the employment history of those involved in lobbying. There are also already existing arrangements in place to scrutinise the future employment of senior civil servants and special advisers, and a restriction on former ministers and special advisers to ensure they do not lobby government for 2 years following the end of their appointment. There is also, as identified by the committee in its report, a power in Section 15 of the Bill that allows the Parliament by resolution to change the details required to be disclosed through the registration process. This power would enable the Parliament to identify further information which it thought appropriate to be included in the register and to do so in a proportionate and focused way. I believe that this is the appropriate way forward for this matter. Accordingly, I'd ask Neil Finlay to withdraw Amendment 19, but if pressed, I'd ask the committee to oppose the amendment.
I invite Neil Finlay to wind up and indicate if he will press a withdrawal.
Yeah, I'm very disappointed with the Minister's response to that. I think this is an essential part of the whole transparency process that this bill is aimed at, and I certainly want to press the amendments.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 19 please indicate? And those against Amendment 19, please indicate. There was one vote in favour of Amendment 19, five against. The amendment is not agreed to. I call Amendment 20 in the name of Neil Finlay, already debated with Amendment 19. Neil Finlay to move or not move?
Move.
Are we all... the question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. With those in favour of Amendment 20, please indicate. And those against, please indicate. There were one vote in favour of Amendment 20, five against. Amendment 20 is not agreed. I call Amendment 21 in the name of Neil Finlay, already debated with Amendment 19. Mr Finlay, to move or not move?
Move.
The amendment is moved. Are we agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 21 please indicate? Would those against 21 please indicate? There was one vote in favour of Amendment 21 and five against. Amendment 21 is not agreed. I call Amendment 22 in the name of Neil Finlay, already debated with Amendment 19. Move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 22, please indicate. And those against, please indicate. There is one vote in favour of 22 and five against. We are not agreed. The question is that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Section 5 is agreed. Call Amendment 23 in the name of Neil Finlay, already debated with Amendment 17. Mr Finlay, move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 23, please indicate. And those against, please indicate. One vote in favour of 23 and five against. The amendment is not agreed. The question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. I call Amendment 24 in the name of Neil Finlay, already debated with Amendment 17. Move or not move? The question is that Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 24 please show? And those against, please show. There were one vote in favour of Amendment 24 and five votes against. Amendment 24 is not agreed. Question is that Sections 7 to 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 25 in the name of Cameron Buchanan, grouped with Amendments 29, 30 and 31. I invite John Scott to move Amendment 25 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This amendment 25 is intended to provide a benefit to registrants, which may incentivise registration in advance and also incentivise voluntary registration. The effect of this amendment is to allow registrants, should they choose, to automatically receive relevant information such as opportunities to participate in consultations and deadlines by which members have to submit amendments. In the EU, there is apparently a system where lobbyists who have registered receive automatic mail notification of new consultations or inquiries, among other incentives. And this seems like a good idea, and the amendment here may prove a useful tool to encourage registration. Amendment 29 would make it a requirement to publish guidance on the register rather than this just being an option by substituting the word may for must. It is essential that everyone affected is clear on the operation and requirements of the register so that it operates smoothly and misunderstandings are kept to a minimum. Having clear guidance is necessary to achieve this, so this amendment would make it absolutely clear that guidance will be published. Amendment 30 would make it a requirement for guidance on the register to include provision about what qualifies as regulated lobbying. This gets to the heart of the matter. We believe where clarity is essential for compliance to be trouble-free and for the registrar's intentions to be met. I move these three amendments.
Thank you. I invite Neil Finlay to speak to Amendment 31 and other amendments in the group.
Amendment 31, this alludes to the question of resources and making sure that the legislation is successfully implemented. We cannot have an ad hoc system. It cannot be done without putting the proper resources into it. And if we're going to have a bill, then it must be fit for purpose and backed by hard cash. In short, we must invest in our democracy, and there must be sufficient resources in place to raise awareness of the changes that this bill will result in. At a seminar recently in Stirling University, the Irish regulator spoke about the need for this, and I agree with her. If the register is to be successfully implemented, and if we're going to have a well-functioning, open and transparent democracy, then that does not come at no cost, and we need to invest in with sufficient resources in this system.
Patricia Ferguson.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very supportive of the idea of there being information provided that allows lobbyists to understand what the system is and how they should comport themselves in relation to that particular system. So I would support the amendments in Neil Finlay's name and also in the name of Cameron Buchanan. However, I wouldn't support Amendment 25. It seems to me that lobbyists, by the very nature of their job, should be aware of such things as parliamentary deadlines, consultations and the like. And I really don't see why parliamentary resources should be expended in order to make that job easier than it currently is. Parliament's information is open to all, freely available on our website, and I think that that should be sufficient.
Minister.
Thank you. Listened with interest to the discussions in this group, and I'll deal with each amendment in turn. On Amendment 25 from Cameron Buchanan, I acknowledge the spirit of the amendment that's been brought forward, but I agree with Patricia Ferguson's view on that. It is important the work of the Parliament is open and accessible, and that those who wish to engage with it can understand what business is being conducted. However, while I recognise ultimately that's a matter for the Parliament itself, the Government doesn't believe it's appropriate or necessary to set out in primary legislation prescriptive requirements about what information the clerk should provide to registered lobbyists. There are already administrative processes in place which interested members of the public or organisations can use, which enable them to keep abreast of parliamentary developments. For example, people can subscribe to receive electronic notification of materials in relation to bills, committees, Parliament news and various other activities within the Parliament. The Parliament also offers the opportunity to receive a weekly e-bulletin. I believe using the facilities already provided by the Parliament continues to be the best way to address this matter, and perhaps Parliament's guidance on the operation of the Act could set out to lobbyists how they could best make use of them. For those reasons, I'd recommend that the committee does not support Amendment 25. On Amendments 29 and 30, it's the Government's view that the guidance which will be developed under the Act will be central to its successful implementation. You know, I think we would all find it difficult to envisage circumstances in which the Parliament would not produce the guidance. On that basis, the Government would be supportive of the committee accepting Amendments 29 and 30. Turning to Amendment 31, it seems to me that it's an amendment in two parts, although strictly speaking, I think the first part, the 2A element, is unnecessary. I can see some benefits in highlighting the Parliament's ability to promote awareness and understanding of the Act. I'm less sympathetic towards the second part, the 2B element, as I think it must be left to the Scottish Parliament corporate body to make decisions about how the use of overall budgets which is available to the Parliament. Consequently, I'd invite Neil Findlay not to move Amendment 31, with the undertaking that I will look to bring forward a government amendment at stage 3, which would deliver on the first part, the 2A element of his amendment. For those reasons, I'd invite committee to resist Amendment 25 and 31 and to support Amendments 29 and 30.
Let me invite John Scott to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 25.
I won't press Amendment 25, given the explanation the Minister has provided.
Are the committee content that withdraw 25? I see no other view. Thank you. I call Amendment 26 in the name of Neil Findlay, already debated with Amendment 17. Move or not move? Mr. Findlay's moved it. The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 26 please show? Would those against please show? There was one vote in favour of Amendment 26 and 5 against. We are not agreed. Question is that Section 15 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. Question is that Sections 16 to 23 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4. Formally moved, please.
Formally moved.
Question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. I call Amendment 27 in the name of Cameron Buchanan, in a group on its own, and I invite John Scott to move and speak to Amendment 27.
Thank you, Convener. As the bill stands, there is some ambiguity as to whether the Commissioner's report to Parliament stating a complaint is admissible will be public knowledge. Our concern is that the identity of the subject of the complaint should only be public if an investigation finds they have failed to comply with the Registrar's requirements. We are concerned that without this amendment, there may be scope for competition-motivated accusations to be made, and the accused could suffer consequences before an investigation has proven an accusation to be either true or false. Exposure to possible reputational damage for the subject of a complaint for failing to comply with requirements should not be possible before any investigation has actually been completed. However, should the Minister be able to clarify that the report to Parliament mentioned in Section 24 would in fact be private from Parliament only, we'd look at that.
Minister.
Okay, I thank Cameron Buchanan for bringing forward this amendment and for John Scott's explanation of its purpose and effect. Convener, I understand the amendment seeks to ensure that no information in relation to an investigation by the Commissioner is made public until such time as the Commissioner has issued their report on the outcome of investigations to the Parliament for consideration as required in Section 22. There's already provision contained in Section 22.4 of the Bill which requires an assessment of admissibility and investigation to be conducted in private. The Government is unsure how the amendment is intended to apply alongside the requirement to tell Parliament and the complainant in Section 24.8 that the complaint has been ruled admissible. There are potential issues about the workability of such an arrangement in the context of the need to keep the complaints procedure private. For example, the need to then enter into confidential agreements with the complainant and the person being complained about and the Parliament. For that reason, I invite John Scott to withdraw Amendment 27, but if not, for the committee to resist them. I'd also like to make clear that if Cameron Buchanan would find it helpful to discuss the matter with my officials and I in advance of Stage 3, I'd be very happy to do so.
I invite John Scott to wind up and indicate if he wishes to press or withdraw Amendment 27.
In the light of the Minister's kind offer to discuss this, the intentions behind this amendment prior to Stage 3, I won't press this amendment and therefore will be happy on Cameron's behalf to accept that invitation for him to discuss this with you prior to Stage 3.
Are members content that Amendment 27 be withdrawn? I see that we are. The question is that Section 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Question is that Sections 25 to 41 are agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 28 in the name of Neil Finlay in a group on its own. I invite Neil Finlay to move and speak to Amendment 28.
This amendment is part of a proportionate system of warning and penalty, a system which alerts organisations to the fact that they may not have as yet registered or fulfilled their responsibilities under the legislation. And then if, after being warned, they still fail to oblige, then a sliding scale of punishment prior to summary conviction is suggested. Ultimately, to a point where they may be banned from operating as a lobbyist. I believe that this, amongst other things, may actually be a greater incentive to ensure that all lobbyists fulfil their obligations than some of the other punishments suggested.
Minister?
Again, thank Neil Finlay for lodging his amendment. Convener, I understand the intention of the amendment is to introduce a more serious penalty for second or subsequent offences under Section 42 of up to the statutory maximum of £10,000, and for that person then to be potentially prevented from lobbying for 3 years. The amendment also seeks to impose an administrative sanction for an offence committed under Section 42 of the Bill in circumstances where a person has been carrying out lobbying activity for 6 months or less. This would create a criminal offence with no criminal penalty. The clerk would simply give the offending person notice advising them about the duty to register. I fully appreciate the spirit in which the amendment seeks to offer registrants some latitude in respect of initial failures to comply with the registration scheme, at least for a time until they fully understand the operation and requirements of the Act. However, I don't think there is a fundamental issue with the amendment. I do think there's a fundamental issue with the amendment in that the outcomes would lack clarity. For example, in relation to the sanction preventing a person from lobbying for 3 years, it's not clear what lobbying someone would be prevented from undertaking. I think Neil Finlay intends to relate that to regulated lobbying as defined in the Bill, but that's not necessarily the effect of the amendment. It's also unclear how the sanction would be enforced. More generally, I have concerns about whether the proposed interference with someone's ability to work is a proportionate response. In addition, it's not clear when the six-month period for determining whether a person is given notice from the clerk or is liable to a fine would apply. It is presumably at the time of committing the offence, but again, that's not necessarily the effect of the amendment. Issues also arise in terms of the clerks having to give notice to a person when they commit an offence. The clerk can already require information under Section 17 of the Bill from an active or voluntary registrant, or where the clerk has reason to believe that a person has failed to provide it. But more importantly, it must be left to the courts to determine whether an offence has or has not been committed, and where an offence has been committed, impose an appropriate criminal sanction. My concerns are not only about the mechanisms of the amendment, but more fundamentally, the Government considers that the existing statutory framework set out in the Bill provides a proportionate approach in respect of offences. The awareness raising, which will be conducted by the Parliament in the run-up to the register becoming operational alongside the guidance to be published by the Parliament, will ensure registrants are aware of what is required of them. Section 16 outlines the clerk's duties to monitor compliance, and Section 17 describes the powers the clerk has to issue information notices requiring a person to supply information. In addition, Section 22 of the Bill provides for the duty of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life to investigate and report on complaints received where a person has failed to comply with the requirements of the Act. Both the provisions of guidance and the role of the clerk and commissioner, backed by the possibility of criminal sanctions, provide an approach which is both fair to the registrants and sufficient to ensure the robustness of the registration regime. I'd ask Neil Finlay to withdraw Amendment 28, but if not, I'd ask the committee to resist it.
Mr Finlay, to wind up and indicate if you are pressing or withdrawing Amendment 28.
Thanks, Convener. At the beginning, it appeared that the Minister supported the principle of what was being said, but through some verbal gymnastics got himself into a position where he is opposing it. If the principle is approved, it does support, then is it possible that the government would work with me to bring that back at stage three in a form that was acceptable to the government? But if that's not the case, then I wish to push the amendment.
I think my view is that I understand the spirit of what Mr Finlay is saying, but I am very clear that the Bill, as drafted, meets the spirit.
Mr Finlay, press
the amendment. Yeah.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 28, please indicate. And those against, please indicate. Thank you. We have one in favour of 28 and five against. It is not agreed. Question is that Section 42 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call on Amendment 29 in the name of Cameron Buchanan, already debated with Amendment 25. I have to ask John Scott to move it again at this stage. Will he move Amendment 29?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 30 in the name of Cameron Buchanan, already debated with Amendment 25. John Scott to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. Question is, Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 31 in the name of Neil Finlay, already debated with Amendment 25. Mr. Finlay, to move or not move?
Move.
Amendment 31 is moved. The question is that Amendment 31 is agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 31 please indicate? And those against? Sorry, let me just be clear. Those in favour of Amendment 31, that's two, thank you. And those against Amendment 31, please indicate, thank you. There were two votes in favour of Amendment 31 and four against. We are not agreed. It is not agreed. The question is that Section 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
The question is that Section 44 be agreed. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4. Minister to move.
Moved.
The question is, Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Question is that Section 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
We're agreed. I call Amendment 32 in the name of Patricia Ferguson, already debated with Amendment 2. Patricia Ferguson to move or not move?
Move.
Amendment 32 is moved. Question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of 32, please indicate. And those against, please indicate. There was one vote in favour and five against. Amendment 32 is disagreed. I call Amendment 33 in the name of Patricia Ferguson, already debated with Amendment 2. Patricia Ferguson to move or not move?
No.
It is moved. Question is that Amendment 33 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 33 and those against. There was one vote in favour and five against. It's not agreed. I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 2. Move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. Question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Question is Section 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is Section 47 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 12 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4. Invite the Minister to move formally.
Move formally.
Moved. The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Question is Section 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 13 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 13A and 13B. I invite the Minister to move Amendment 13 and speak to all the other amendments in the group.
Convener, paragraph 100 of the committee Stage 1 report highlighted that a number of those responding to the committee called for a review after an agreed period so that Parliament could revisit and revise the legislation. The Government agrees that there would be merit in conducting a review to consider how successful the regime has operated and whether any changes should be made in light of the review. That's a process which would allow proper consideration of whether potentially significant changes should be made to the regulated lobbying regime rather than amending the bill now in ways which might put at risk the key principles of openness and accessibility which have underpinned the Government and the Committee's approach to this legislation. Putting in place a review mechanism enables the Parliament to gather information and to establish an evidence base to support and justify any case for change. That's why Amendment 13 in my name would require the Parliament to conduct a review of the lobbying register after its first 2 years of formal operation. While it will be for the Parliament to determine the form and content of its final report, the Government believes it is important to recognise certain issues have attracted particular attention during the Bill's development and parliamentary passage. Therefore, the provision specifies that the report may in particular contain recommendations about whether to add or modify the types of person who would be treated as lobbyees under the regulated lobbying system, whether to add or to modify the types of communication which would be treated as regulated lobbying activity, and whether lobbyists undertaking regulated lobbying activity should be required to provide information about expenditure incurred in carrying out that regulated lobbying activity. Convener, I'd expect the Parliament's review to be thorough and wide-ranging. Once it's been completed, it would then be a matter for the Parliament to determine whether it wished to use any of the existing powers in the Act to make changes to the administration of the Register or to bring forward further primary legislation in, if it considered that a more fundamental policy changes was required. Turning now to Cameron Buchanan's Amendment 13A and 13B, I'd like to take the opportunity to explain to the committee that while I appreciate the basis at which they have been brought forward, I cannot recommend that they are supported. Amendment 13A would reduce from 2 years to 1 year the period on which the Parliament's review would be conducted, and I really don't believe that 1 year of operation of the Register would be sufficient time on which to base an informed analysis. Information returns will be provided by lobbyists on a 6-monthly basis, and I believe the Parliament would wish to enable that cycle to be completed more than once before conducting its review. Similarly, Cameron Buchanan's Amendment 13B would reduce from 2 years to 1 year the period in which the Parliament would have to conduct and complete its review. In light of the expectation that the Parliament will consult both in developing its evidence base and in its draft recommendations, I don't believe it would be appropriate to require it to be completed in 1 year. However, it's important to remember that the Government's proposal of a 2-year limit is the maximum time the Parliament will have to complete its review. It would therefore be open to Parliament to complete its review more quickly than that, should it wish to. So, Convener, in conclusion, I move and invite committee to support Amendment 13 in my name, and for John Scott not to press Amendments 13A and 13B, but if he does so, for the committee to resist them.
I invite John Scott at this stage to move Amendment 13A and to speak to all the amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And speaking to Amendments 13A and B, we agree that it would be wise to review the operation of the Register after we, and indeed all concerned, have gained practical experience of its operation. However, the Government's amendment only requires that a report is published within the period of 4 years after enactment, which is the sum of the 2-year review period and a subsequent 2-year period to report. This process makes sense, but the timing appears to be too long, we think. If there are issues or gaps in the Register that are serious enough to warrant revision, it is likely that it will be apparent within a year of the Register's operation. Furthermore, it should be possible to report on the Register's operation within a year when the aim is to review rather than create from scratch. Given this, we suggest that the Government's amendment is changed to reduce the time by which a report is to be published to 2 years. These amendments will achieve this by reducing the review period to 1 year and reducing the report period to 1 year as well. And I will press this amendment.
So you have moved it.
I will move it.
Thank you very much. Patricia Ferguson.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very sympathetic to the Government's amendments which seek to have the review period introduced. I think that's absolutely necessary. And I actually don't have a problem with the review taking place 2 years after, in effect, the Bill comes into force. However, I do have some sympathy with Cameron Buchanan's Amendment 13B, simply in relation to parliamentary cycles. If the bill is to be reviewed after 2 years and Parliament has up to 2 years to do that, then that in effect means any resulting work on the bill would take place at the very end of a session, and the likelihood would be that it would either be rushed at the end of a session or that it may even not happen until the next parliamentary session. It seems to me that if there are issues, flaws, faults, improvements that can be made to the bill, that we should do it within a reasonable time frame and certainly within the lifetime of the next Parliament. So for that reason, I wouldn't support 13A, but I would support 13B.
Minister.
I think Patricia Ferguson makes some particularly good points there, and obviously, as the bill is drafted, it would allow the Parliament to do that process faster if it chose to. I think 13B would put a particular rigid framework in, which might not work within the next Parliament's timetable. And obviously, it won't be for government to be doing that review. It'll be for the Parliament to frame that review. So I think it is better to give the Parliament that flexibility going forward. So I think I would continue to. While I hear there are some arguments there, I think it's appropriate to resist 13A and 13B.
I invite John Scott, if he wishes, to wind up on Amendment 13A and indicate if he's pressing or withdrawing.
I hear very much what the Minister is saying, and I welcome what he said in his opening remarks, that if a review could take less than 2 years, and I think that is to be welcomed very much. And as Patricia Ferguson has said, in the normal cycle of parliamentary events, which we seem to have got out of for the time being, but nonetheless, it would be at the end of a parliament and therefore would be less likely to be acted upon expeditiously. And so I will continue to press both these amendments, if I may.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 13A be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of 13A please indicate? And those against? There is one person in favour of 13A and five against. It is not agreed. I call Amendment 13B in the name of Cameron Buchanan, already debated with Amendment 13. I invite John Scott to move or not move 13B.
Moved.
13B has been moved. The question is that Amendment 13B be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not. There will be a division. Would those in favour of 13B please indicate? And those against 13B please indicate. There were two votes in favour of 13B and four against. We are not. It is not agreed. I ask the Minister if he now wishes to press or withdraw Amendment 13.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. The question is that Section 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 34 in the name of Cameron Buchanan, grouped with Amendment 35. I invite John Scott to move Amendment 34 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. Amendment 34 would require the register to be operational at least 3 months before the registration requirements come into force. And the intention of this is to allow potential registrants to become accustomed to using the register so that any technical difficulties or misunderstandings can be addressed before sanctions come into force. It is important that registrants are able to experience practical use of the register if they are to be ready when requirements come into force. Amendment 35 would require the guidance to be published at least 3 months before the registration requirements come into force. The intention of this is to allow potential registrants to understand their requirements in advance so that any action needed to comply can be taken before enforcement. This would give registrants a better chance to come to grips and get to grips with the register without fear of falling foul of the requirements.
Thank you, Minister.
Again, if I can thank Cameron Buchanan for lodging his amendments and John Scott's explanation of their purpose and effect. The Government's position is that implementation of the Act is properly a matter for Parliament and that the Government will be steered by it in determining when relevant provisions of the Bill should be commenced. While I accept the underlying spirit of Cameron Buchanan's amendments, ensuring that the mechanics of the register and guidance are in place before the duty to register bites on lobbyists, I don't believe it's necessary to set this out on the face of the bill. The Government's preference would be to leave it to the Parliament's discretion to determine when the provision of the bill should be commenced and the order in which that takes place. In doing so, it's the Government's expectation that the Parliament will wish to ensure that guidance on the operation of the Act has been produced, and that support will be available to those lobbyists who may be required to register their lobbying activity. For those reasons, I would invite John Scott not to press Amendment 34.
I invite John Scott to wind up and indicate if he's pressing or withdrawing.
I will press the amendment, thank you, and have nothing further to add.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yeah. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 34 please indicate? And those against? There is one in favour and five against. Amendment 34 is not agreed. Call Amendment 35 in the name of Cameron Buchanan, already debated with Amendment 34. John Scott to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Would those in favour of Amendment 35 please indicate? And those against Amendment 35 please indicate? There was one in favour of 35 and five against. Amendment 35 is not agreed. Question is that Section 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We're agreed. The question is that Section 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Thank you. That ends Stage 2 consideration of the bill. Oh, sorry. One moment, please.
Convener, if I could just crave your indulgence while the Minister is still with us. I just wondered if a date had been established yet for the Stage 3 consideration, just to give colleagues around the table the opportunity to think about the framing of amendments
for
that stage.
I'll come back to members on that.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Early indication would certainly be helpful, Minister. Thank you very much. We now come to agenda item 4, which is about Chapter 7B of the Standing Orders. We have a note from the clerks regarding this, and I invite general comments from members on the note before us. We have at section 17 of the note before us three suggestions as to matters we might care to agree. First of all, that we could make no changes to standing orders, having considered the issues that Mary Fees raised. We can give further consideration to standing order rule changes, or we can highlight this is a legacy issue for next session's committee. And indeed, there may be other options that members wish to draw to our attention. Yes, Fiona.
Convener, very useful paper again to try and get our heads around this. I'd like to suggest that I think there is another option. And if I can go through the three that we've been given and give my reasons for why I think we need a fourth option. To say that we should make no changes to standing orders, you know that, and I said it last week, I'm very reluctant to change standing orders without careful consideration. But I think this issue over the trade union bill has highlighted that this is an issue worth pursuing. And it came to thinking about in terms of the Westminster change to English votes for English laws. So there may well be times when the Westminster government says it's about England only, but we will see that there may be impacts on Scotland. So for that reason, I don't think we can say an absolute no to changing standing orders. But I would say for point two, yes, give further consideration to standing orders. But I go back to what I've always said previously. We shouldn't be doing a change to standing orders as almost a knee-jerk reaction to what the trade union bill threw up. But given what I've already said, I do think we have to consider if this needs to be done in a wider view. And to say that we should highlight it as a legacy issue, I think is very important. But given what has the discussion that has been around that trade union bill and now this thinking of different laws that could be happening, the way things are changing in Westminster, I think for us to leave it as a legacy issue is perhaps leaving it in the hands of another committee that hasn't done that original thinking. So I would like to suggest a fourth option, which is that we do start thinking about it now, but I don't want us to rush into anything. So I want us to give it a considered thought over the next few weeks, at which point we can then say, have we had enough time to make a change, or have we had enough time to consider whether it is something to suggest to the next committee? I can have one question to the clerks, because we talked about, last week when we talked about this, we talked about the Welsh Parliament Assembly had decided that they would vote against an LCM for, in their situation, and I was just wondering what happened in Wales with that vote and whether Westminster took any consideration of it at all.
My understanding is that the Welsh Assembly did agree that there should be an LCM, but I don't know how the Westminster government's responding to that.
Right. Might be worth us having a wee look.
But we are in touch with the Welsh clerks about developments there.
Okay, that's fine. That's something which hopefully we'll get further information on at a later point. Fiona's made some interesting comments there. Has anyone else wish to make any comment? Because if not, then that's the basis we'd move forward on. Michael.
Yeah, I think Fiona raises an interesting possibility. I have, as I said last week, I'm resistant to changing standing orders because there's a disputed ruling by the presiding officer. But I do accept that the evil situation may change things, and it may produce circumstances in which obnoxious legislation such as this, and I repeat the word I used last week, this obnoxious legislation will, in some interpretations, be difficult to deal with. Legislative consent motions have no force. I'd be very interested to see what has happened with Wales, but I suspect I could predict what the reaction of the Westminster government will be, which will be nothing at all. They will not be moved by it. But perhaps we do need to create a different category, another category, that deals with legislation which appears to be, and the government of the day at Westminster says is only to do with England and Wales, but which we believe has much wider consequences. So I think that's worth doing, and I think Fiona's also right to say that's not doing nothing, that's saying what we can do, and we should try and consider that before the end of the session. I think there's time to do so. So if we were to look at this over the next 2 or 3 weeks, we might be in a position to make a recommendation to the next Parliament, because there will be other recommendations to the next Parliament. I wasn't a member of this committee when it was drawing up its report on procedures, but I did give evidence to it, and there will be the need for the next Parliament to consider some urgent changes at a very early stage. So this might be one of them at the very start of the next session.
Patricia?
I think we have to remember why we're looking at this paper today, and the reason for that is because Mary Fee sent a letter to the committee asking that a rule change should be considered, and that was also part of an amendment agreed by the majority of parliamentarians in debate. Now, clearly the amendment had to be worded in such a way that it would be competent, but the clear intent of that was that we should focus on what was happening with the trade union bill, which is a clear and present danger, frankly, and that we should do so with a view to this Parliament being able to suggest to the UK government by means of an LCM the very clear opinion of the Parliament that the trade union bill is a bad thing and that Scotland should be treated differently for all the reasons we rehearsed in the debate, which I'll not rehearse here. Clearly there is a timetable for that bill, and I think it's very important that anything we do is sorry, I may have lost my microphone, or maybe I have the microphone. Sorry, I have. Sorry. So we have to consider anything that we're doing in relation to the timetable for that bill. Otherwise, the discussion is frankly moot. So I think we do press ahead with the work on a change to standing orders in the knowledge that that is, in effect, what Parliament was asking us to do.
Dave Thompson.
Convener. I think what this whole matter has thrown up
very starkly, in fact, is the absolute lack of status of the LCMs. And in the paper before us, in paragraph 11, it says very clearly, the procedure itself has no status or special effect, and any clear expression of the will of the Parliament will be effective. So it actually shows us very clearly that LCMs are really they're not worth the paper they're written on. And I think that the response to the Welsh Assembly's vote on an LCM will be very understanding, and I agree with Mike Russell. I think Westminster will just say tough, because it highlights very clearly where the power lies, and the power lies in London. However, having said that, we do need to move this forward. We do need to discuss this, and I think we should do it as quickly as we can and see where we get to with that by the time the Parliament goes into dissolution.
Yes, John.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm not sure if I should be declaring an interest as a Deputy Presiding Officer or not, but I speak as a member of the Scottish Parliament, but although I'm fully supportive of the Presiding Officer's position. I'm reluctant to see a change to standing orders. I think while it is the will of Parliament, I think nonetheless it might be perceived as a knee-jerk reaction. And therefore, the old maxim is act in haste, repent at leisure. I don't see knee-jerk reactions. They've never been regarded as the basis for creating good law. Further, I would say that we still have to await the arrival of Smith and see how this interacts with all of this. I have to confess I'm not absolutely up to speed on whether or not there will be an interaction with the proposals. However, I think it would not be unreasonable for Parliament to look into this without prejudice, and I think it should be an issue that the next session of Parliament, in due course and over time, and after proper consideration, comes to a view on, and I think that would be a reasonable way forward.
I'll come to Patricia, just make a brief observation that I think clearly there is a sense in the committee that we are not closing this off today. That's quite clear to me. I think we do need to address issues of what process do we now adopt, what content are we looking to develop, and what timing are we going to use to do all that. And I think that's, you know, in our deliberations in considering the matter, we have to address that. Perhaps it would be helpful if you address that in addition to anything else you wanted to say, Patricia.
Yeah, it just strikes me, Convener, that I think we're actually in danger of being sidelined into a completely separate and different debate, because talk of evil and the Smith Commission, while they are very, very important, and I don't say that they shouldn't be the subject of work by this committee, I think it would be very interesting to look at those. However, I would just, as Dave Thompson did, refer members to paragraph 11 of our paper, where it says that the Convention does not specify how consent of the Parliament, or indeed absence of that consent, is to be obtained or expressed. Chapter 9B sets out the procedure that the Parliament has chosen to help it deal with legislative consent in an appropriate and consistent way. And it is the 9B provision that has prevented us having an LCM. Whether it's effective or otherwise is not part of my argument. But my argument is that Parliament clearly thought that it should have an LCM. That was ruled out by the presiding officer, quoting Chapter 9B as her rationale for doing so, and therefore our attention should be focused on whether or not we wish to amend Section 9B.
Mike,
I think we do.
I go back to the point that I regard the trade union bill as obnoxious. Parliament has said it is obnoxious. It can say it again and again in whatever format it wishes. Regrettably, the reality of the situation we're in is Westminster hold the cards. What we need is a circumstance in which if we do need any change, we can actually express that about bills which may be defined either by the government of the day or by other rulings as not bills that are subject to LCMs. And I think Fiona's proposal gets us into that next stage, and that's good. And maybe, if Patricia believes that that should be done before the end of the session, that is possible, though I tend to sympathise with what John says, that to rush this in a way that might get it wrong would not necessarily be sensible. But I don't think we should be, go back to where I was last week, we should not be making changes to the existing standing orders because we object to a single ruling by the presiding officer, whether or not we believe it is right or wrong.
Certainly, not speaking as convener, but as an individual, I think at the end of the day, there is a difficulty if we seek to take from the presiding officer the custody of standing orders and the interpretation, or be seen to. I'm not sure we're necessarily there, but I think there is a risk in this. Now, Fiona, let me come back to you, because I've made the suggestion that whatever we end up with, we need to understand the process from here, the content that we might address and the timing. Do you have anything to add to what you've previously said that might help us in that regard?
I'm not sure if I get anything that would help. I mean, I just come back to the paragraph in Mary Fee's letter to us, where she says she's asking our committee to provide the opportunity to vote on an immediate change of standing orders. And an immediate change, I don't think, is the right way to approach changing standing orders. When you read through the paper that we've got this week and we had last week, I'm very struck about how this is a standing order of the Scottish Parliament. We have to look at it, but it's about how it fits into, what does DGN stand for? The Devolution Guidance Note, the Memorandum of Understanding. It's about aligning them. And I think to make an immediate change without us understanding that if we change a standing order that interrupts that alignment, will it have the effect that we wish it to have? Or will it again be an empty gesture of us shouting into the wind because there's an MOU and a DGN? So for me, I would like to start working on that, get that sort of idea behind, you know, what it is, and that could perhaps help us to formulate more exactly what it is we need to be doing.
That's fine in a sense. Could you perhaps illuminate a little more of the process? Are you, and just to throw in, I'm merely throwing these in as things that we might as a committee do. Are you envisaging that we should invite evidence from people? What is the process from here?
Can we, because I appreciate Patricia's point that, you know, that there is a demand in some quarters for immediate change, we should probably look at, if we could, two draft standing orders, one of which would achieve what Patricia wants to achieve, one of which would achieve what Fiona wants to achieve, and we could make a choice.
Right. I'll come to you in a second, Patricia. Just, I as convener, I want to be just quite clear where we're heading today. At the moment, as a matter of process, we have a very specific set of words that Mary Fee has proposed that be put as a change standing orders. So, on one side of the discussion, I have a clear set of words, and there's no ambiguity. On the other side, I don't yet have a clear set of words. And that leaves me as convener with a bit of a difficulty, I have to say, in that I can't put two propositions.
It's clear. And I think the clerks would be able to capture that concept in a draft standing order. The concept is that there would be an additional category, 8, whatever it is, which would be for legislation for which a legislative consent motion was either not sought, not permitted, whatever the language is, and that category would allow the Parliament to give an opinion of that, even if there was not a legislative consent motion.
So we're looking at, and I merely pluck this out of there, a 9C paragraph,
yeah,
which has something appropriate in it. No, Patricia, you've been dying to come in.
We got this paper on the basis of the letter we had from Mary Fee and people being anxious about not rushing into making a change without considering what is before us. But we're now proposing that we should rush into something else without having a paper to consider before us.
Yep.
Well, I think we are. And the paper that we have in front of us is talking very specifically about the situation that applies in relation to Chapter 9B and the Trade Union Bill. Now, either we want to do something about the Trade Union Bill as far as we possibly can, or we don't, and that's quite a straightforward matter. However, any other change that brought in anything new to deal with any perceived circumstances would, in and of itself, have no more status than an LCM. And I really don't see why we would at this stage want to open up that debate when we don't actually have Smith finalised, when we've got a devolution for the Powers Committee who's looking at all of that. Whereas with 9B, we have a recommendation from the Devolution for the Powers Committee. We have a view, it's not necessarily a recommendation, and we have the view of Parliament. We really need to focus on that, because if not, then we're abrogating the responsibility that our colleagues have given to us in this regard.
Oh, no, I utterly reject that. There's no abrogation of responsibility. This committee is performing the function for which it exists, not only to consider standing orders, but also to be part of the stewardship of standing orders. And it is absolutely right that that function is fulfilled. So I absolutely reject that. And I also reject, and I'm not saying, convener, that the member is pushing... I'm not saying that the member is pushing us this way, but I think we're in danger of an interpretation being given that if you're not in favour of the change that Mary Fee has suggested, you are in some sense in favour of the Trade Union Bill. Can I repeat for the third time, as strongly as I can, for the record, I regard the Trade Union Bill as obnoxious, uniquely obnoxious. But equally, if we were to overrule the presiding officer, essentially by changing the rules because we disliked a single ruling of hers, that would be the wrong thing to do for the future of this Parliament. So the question is how we move forward. I think Fiona has made a positive suggestion. It would seem to me that that's something we could consider. But just simply to assent to Mary Fee on the grounds that if we don't, we are in some sense wimpish about the Trade Union Bill and in some sense defying the will of Parliament, I reject both of those absolutely.
Can I just say I've just taken some advice on one aspect of this to be clear what difference there is when it's an LCM. To a motion identically worded that is not described in the LCM. And there is one difference. And I will be hauled in if I get this wrong. And the one difference is when it's an LCM, the Clerk of the Parliament writes to the Clerk of Westminster to draw Westminster's formal attention to the opinion of the Parliament. I think when it is not an LCM, that process does not of necessity take place. It is not prevented from taking place. And I think that's possibly the immediate today missing link that we might care to discuss.
Easily bridged.
Now, Mr. Russell, if I will forgive me, Mr. Thompson has been catching my quite agitatedly for some time, and I will give him his due and come back to you.
Thank you, convener, and I deny being agitated. As a lifelong trade unionist who organised his first strike when he was 14 years old, I, like Mike Russell and many folk in this Parliament, abhor what is happening with the Trade Union Bill being imposed on us by Westminster. My father was also a trade union activist in Murrayshire, a very strong Tory area back in the 30s and so on, which was a very difficult thing to do because it was very easy to be a trade unionist in Red Clydeside, where everybody else was a trade unionist, but in Murrayshire, you were very much on your own. If we move too quickly on this, and if any suggestion is made that Parliament takes over responsibility for these decisions as opposed to the PO, I think we would be in real danger of getting ourselves into very dangerous ground. This has got to be dealt with properly, with proper thought, and it has nothing to do with anybody's position on the Trade Union Bill, where Mike and I and others have made our positions very, very clear. It's about proper governance and proper procedure within this Parliament, and we in the Procedures Committee have a duty to make sure we get these things right.
I think I'll come to Mike, Patricia and John.
Well, if the issue is the letter from the clerk to the clerk at Westminster, it would be possible by special resolution, I'm sure, to request that. And indeed, I'd be happy to support that if any member were to put down a motion saying, drawing attention to the debate that took place on the trade union bill, and to say, there's information and that's it, fine. But to change our entire standing orders in order to do that, I think is highly dangerous.
I would just say I support what Mike Russell has said, and I also support what Dave Thompson has said. Forgive me, Patricia, for jumping in before you, but we are also the custodians of the law here in Parliament as well as the creators of it. And I think, as I said earlier, it would be a pity to act in haste and repent at leisure, and that there's a real danger of doing something precipitate here that is not reasonable. And I think we should avoid that at all costs.
Patricia.
Thank you, Convener. For the avoidance of doubt, I'm not accusing anyone of being in favour of the trade union bill. I don't see how any right-thinking person could be, quite frankly. And I don't feel the need to rehearse my trade union credentials in order to back up what I'm saying. Most of us in this room are trade unionists and probably active trade unionists to a greater or lesser extent. And I suspect we're all very proud of that fact. This isn't about whether or not you're in favour of this particular bill. Now, when we had the debate, I was conscious of the fact that a letter would go from the Clerk of the Parliament to his opposite number at Westminster if an LCM had been passed. And for that reason, I suggested in my speech at the time that perhaps our business managers might collectively like to go with a copy of the official report and present it to 10 Downing Street. And I still think that might be something they would like to do. I would certainly be happy to join them to do it if they wished me to be there. And I'm sure many of us would. But the point I'm trying to make is that I jealously guard Parliament's rules and regulations too, and as someone who was a deputy presiding officer in a previous life a very long time ago now, I have a lot of sympathy with the idea that we shouldn't move precipitately to change standing orders. But the fact of the matter is, that's the discussion we had last week. And as a result of that discussion, we have this paper in front of us today, which was supposed to facilitate us having a discussion about whether or not we wish to move to change the standing orders. I am of the opinion that we do. Others may have a different view. And that isn't about whether or not you're in favour of the trade union bill or not. That's just about a procedural issue. And I think we probably have rehearsed all the arguments, quite frankly, and I think we should just move to a decision on it.
Just one moment, please, John. Let me just put to you what the sense I'm getting from you and test whether I'm reading what's going on. We're agreed we're not intending in this meeting to revisit the substantive issue of the trade union bill as such. I think that's beyond doubt. I think the second thing is I'm getting a pretty strong but not unanimous sense that we do not wish to recommend the change that Mary Fee has put to us at this stage and in this form. I equally get the sense that we would wish to encourage Parliament, by means as yet perhaps not fully understood, to ensure that Parliament formally notifies the Westminster of Parliament's views on this piece of Westminster legislation, as would have been the case in if an LCM had been passed. As I say, I think we have to explore how that might be done. Just one moment, John. Just one moment. And I think, too, we haven't rejected and therefore still have on the table the proposal from Fiona that we look further, having dealt with the immediate issue in the way I think we're getting to, at whether there are standing order changes that are appropriate to make. Now, let me just put it to colleagues. Have I sensibly summarised where we are just now? Patricia, in particular, I addressed my question at.
Yes, but my fear is that we're losing our focus.
No, I understand and respect the point Patricia Ferguson makes, but I think, you know, in the summary I've come up with, what I'm proposing to enable us to complete what we're going to do today, but not
the issue, is that we are not at this stage agreeing to bring forward the change that Mary Fee has suggested. Neither are we yet dismissing it, I hasten to say. We are inviting Fiona perhaps to work with the clerks in bringing forward an alternative formulation. I think that has to happen, but we'll invite the clerks to consider that. But I would invite Fiona to, just one wee second, if I may. We're also going to invite the clerks to explore how, in a proper formal sense, we can get the Parliament to notify Westminster of the view that we've expressed through a non-LCM motion. John.
I would just like to say that if it is the intention or the will of this committee to notify Westminster of the view of the Scottish Parliament, and a view which I'm certain they are aware of anyway, but nonetheless, what we do must be done within the remit that we have in terms of the Scotland Act, and therefore must not be ultra vires. I would not, this is difficult, but I would not wish it to be seen to be challenging how the authority of the presiding officer either. I think that is vitally important to the principles of our Parliament. And I would, I have already suggested, reiterate it again, with additionality, in as much as this committee will doubtless have a legacy document which all other committees have as we run up to dissolution. And either this should be number one, if that is the view of this committee, and I'm very aware that I'm a guest on this committee today, that it should be high up the legacy document of things to be addressed, or indeed, as I've said, begin an inquiry into this whole process within while we await the outcome of the Smith Commission and its effect on our Parliament in due course. I think, I'm repeating myself, I know, but I think it might be precipitate to do this before the full impact and implications of Smith are in front of us.
John, you are a full member of this committee while you are here as a substitute member, so I'm delighted to see you, but you are substantially more than mere guest. Patricia.
Thank you, Convener. I think in your summary prior to John Scott's contribution, you mentioned that Fiona's suggestion was an alternative to this. I actually don't see it as an alternative. I see it as a different work stream. And I think the two things have to be kept separate because we have to dispose of this one way or another. Anything else is a different matter.
I think Patricia makes a fair point. What I was seeking to do was not necessarily to put the two in opposition because we don't know the other proposition if one emerges. So we can't yet say if we could do that. All I'm saying is that we don't dispose of Mary Fee's proposal at this stage until we see what other proposal might be that be additional to Mary or in distinction to Mary. And I simply don't know where we're going to get on that at this stage.
I thought your summary was entirely fair. I think if we proceeded on that basis, then we would want to dispose of this at our next meeting. But yeah, we need to get a little bit more.
Right. Now, just for clarity as well, I don't envisage that this committee has the power to take the action on notifying Westminster, but we have the power to ask that we go away and find out how that may be done and what the processes are. And I think it is that I'm suggesting, just for clarity, in case there is any other. Now, the clerk's quite clear on that matter. Right. OK, I think that draws this to a conclusion, unless anyone is...
I'm not sending you with a letter.
Not unless Parliament takes a quite extraordinary decision. Parliament would have the power to send me if it chose to do so, and I would, of course, do it. However, colleagues, I think we've now reached the end of our meeting, unless anyone has any... Patricia.
I'd like to make one very brief point, yes? And that is, Convener, that last week we agreed that we weren't going to dispose of the item concerning Mary Fee's letter and the consequences thereof, that we would get a paper and we would do that this week. Now we seem to be saying we're going to do it next week. Can I respectfully ask that next week we absolutely come to a decision because the timetable is tight.
I think at this stage I can only note your observation, but absolutely understand timetable, which is why, of course, when the subject first came up, I did spell out our understanding of the parliamentary timetable at Westminster. Right. On that basis, I think that concludes today's meeting. Thank you for your support and assistance, and I will see you. That sounds like we're going to be here next week again, briefly, not for the stage two, but to address this issue. 9:30 probably will be good enough, I think. Thank you. All right. Thank you very much.